Tigozi Obioma é escritor, professor de literatura e escrita criativa da Universidade de Nebraska, Lincoln. É negro e nigeriano.
Senhoras e senhores, o Minas Negras Gerais de hoje recebe uma grande honra, nosso irmão Tigozi Obioma. Okolofé, Tigozi.
Okolofé.
Are you okay?
Yes, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
It's a pleasure to have you here with us. Such a honor. Well, you were nominated by the New York Times book review as the hero of Chinua Achebe. How do you feel about that?
Well, how I felt was obviously that the hair thing, the bequeathing of hairship, you know, is not something that I'm necessarily interested in. But obviously, I was flattered by the comparison, you know, between myself, my work, and that of, you know, the great Nigerian writer, who is also believed to be the father of African literature, at least modern African literature. I think that in many ways, our work do have similarities, especially our first novels. So Achebe's Things Fall Apart, which was published in 1956, I think it was really in many ways a novel that attempted to understand and reveal to the world, to the readership, what the African, West African culture was like, you know, using these Igbo specific culture in Eastern Nigeria as an example. It was in many ways a response to a gap in literature that existed at the time. So most of the literature that were written about Africans were by Europeans or by, you know, colonialist people, and so their depiction of course was filtered by their biases and prejudices. So the Things Fall Apart sought to establish a kind of a narrative about how the Africans lived their culture, the fact that they had a sophisticated you know, religious system, socio-political system, you know, like society functionally was ordered, not in a chaotic way, but in an organized way that was divorced from, you know, how the Western structure or Western influences. So in many ways, The Fisherman, which was my first novel published in 2015, and 2016 in Brazil by Globo Editora, you know, that novel, yeah, works in a similar way. It tries to investigate, okay, 50 years after Nigeria received independence from Britain, why is this still not as developed as everyone thought it would with all the potential at the time? So the explanation there at the heart of the novel is that, well, the creation of the state itself, the the structure into which we thought was ours was not ours. It was created by these people, and therefore it was defaulted. It was faulty from the beginning. So that's really the ways in which my work bears affinity to that of Achebe.
Mm-hmm. That's right. See, you had a lifetime studying ciphers, don't you? Haven't you?
Yes, I moved from Nigeria in 2007 and moved to Cyprus, where I did college. So that movement was very interesting because it opened up a lot of things for me, one of which was it allowed me to think about Nigeria from a distance and also to see it from a distance, which was partly where, you know, the fisherman was actually born.
Mm-hmm. Your novel, An Orchestra of Minorities, introduces us to a character which is called Chinoso, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Which is a young poultry farmer who saved the life of a girl called Nidali, who almost commits suicide and consequently falls in love with him and vice versa. In an attempt to prove to her wealthy parents that he is capable to be socially acceptable, he sells almost all of his possessions and he goes to Cyprus to study as well. And my question is it a coincidence, or have you made a combination of some of his own experience with some of your own experiences and his experiences?
So fiction for me is usually a montage of many things. It's an accumulation of lived experiences. What the fiction writer does is that you bring all these things together and then remold them in such a way that even the lived experiences is sometimes unrecognizable by those who have lived it. So that's what I attempt to do in my fiction, which means that more often than not, the fiction that I create has a figment or a fraction of my own lived experience in it. So that is true of both novels that I've, you know, released so far. But in An Orchestra of Minorities specifically, that novel was informed largely by an experience I had while in Cyprus, which was that there was this guy who I met who had sold everything he had, just like Chinoso, whom you just talked about in your introduction. So this guy, whose name was Jay, had been deceived by, you know, con men in Nigeria that, you know, look, Cyprus is like a developed country. It's like places in Europe or America or Canada. So come there and pay us, and once you get there, your life will be good. So, but on getting to the north of Cyprus, so there are two Cypruses, two countries. It's a divided country. So the south is in the European Union. It's an actual country, but the north is not. The north is under international embargo. So it's not very developed. In fact, it was at the time as probably of the same standard. Or Nigeria, in fact, I think was better than that country. So anyway, so he got there and then he discovered that he had been lied to. So he was crushed internally by this revelation. And so I saw firsthand how he began to break down. So that internal collapse led to a kind of a tragic end. A few days afterwards, he was declared missing. So we're looking for him. The police were looking for him. And then eventually he was found behind a crack at the basement of outside somewhere. I can't even describe that place. It was like behind a lift. He had fallen off an elevator, you know, and had died. He landed with his head. So what happened was he went, he got very drunk. and went up to the attic of the building, and then I think he was trying to walk back down, but he walked over, you know, and then he fell down. Or he was trying to take an elevator, and so somehow we just found out that he was dead. He had fallen from the top of that building. So the death was tragic, and so in the aftermath of that death, I began to ask myself, you know, certain questions about this guy's unfortunate life. And one thing that stayed with me the most, that was recurrent in my mind, was something that he had told me during the short period when I knew him. He'd mentioned that the reason why he came to Cyprus was because he was in love with someone, a woman to whom he was engaged, and he wanted to come to Cyprus to make money quickly and go back to marry her. So that's what led me to start thinking, okay, how can I retrace the step of this guy in form of fiction?
Yeah. It was just you were just comparing situations over there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you brought it into your book.
That's exactly true. So I you know, lifted that story and made fiction out of it.
Mm-hmm. That's right. The story of the book is set on the outskirts of Umuahia, Nigeria, and narrated by a chi, or guardian spirit. The belief in a spirituality seems to be immersed on your writings. We could also find a real stories in Portuguese narrated by the spirits. My question is, how would you relate your ancestry and spirituality, and how do they intervene on your work?
So one of the things that have been my greatest concern in my work, you know, the stuff that I want to explore has always been that I want to discover the gaps in the literature of Africa, specifically that of Nigeria. So what are the things that other people are doing in the literature that we've not done or are not doing enough of? In that way, I have found that we've not explored the richness and wealth of the cosmologies, the religious aspects of our lives, as well as the, you know, just the depth of the philosophies that we had. So if you talk about philosophy as it is studied anywhere across the world, mostly, you will start getting names like Hegel, you know, Husserl, Foucault, and Marx, you know, and so these are European people. So and philosophy really is knowledge, it's ideas, it's how political structures are put in place. These are usually the epistemology of these knowledges that form institutions in the world. So does it mean that other people did not have philosophies or were not thinking? No, they had, it was just different. So that is why I have, you know, I wrote this novel really, and Across of Minorities. So for me, I wanted to explore the rich, sophisticated cosmology of the Igbo people writ large in their spirituality. So, and I wanted to produce a text that will be to the African, or even to the Black diaspora, what Dante's Inferno, for instance, you know, or Milton's Paradise Lost, which gives, you know, an account of the creation of the world in the Judeo-Christian Western viewpoint. So I wanted to put something like that. So at the heart of all that is the chi, you know, in the Igbo cosmology. So in Brazil, for instance, you guys are, you know more about the Yoruba, the Southwestern, you know, cosmology of the Yoruba people. So, but the Eastern one has not really been put forth, right? Really, Achebe has done some work on it, and there is, of course, a wealth of nonfiction around it. So, but at the heart of the Igbo cosmology and spirituality is the Chi. So, as my name, for instance, says, Chi Gozie, you know, that Chi is the spirit that is believed to ensoul every individual that comes into the world, and it stays with them. And once they are dead, it ascends and then, you know, gives an account of their life and then reincarnates. It returns to the world in form of another human being.
And do you believe in reincarnation?
Yes, the Igbos do. Yes.
Como outros espíritos guardiões, já estive em Ua, em muitos ciclos de reencarnação, cada vez habitando um corpo recém-criado. Vim rapidamente, voando desimpedido como uma lança, atravessando o espaço imenso do universo, porque minha mensagem é urgente.
Brazil e Nigeria have many things in common. How would you compare both countries and how would you evaluate their situation nowadays?
Well, so one direct similarity is that I think Brazil has the largest population of black people in the world, is it?
Yeah, especially in Bahia.
Okay. Yeah. Followed by Nigeria.
That's right.
A Nigéria tem cerca de 200 milhões de habitantes, sendo que 97% deles são negros. É o país mais populoso do continente africano e com a maior população negra do mundo. Neste ranking, em segundo lugar, está o Brasil.
Não sei qual, acho que é o Brasil que tem mais, não estou certo.
Bahia is considered the part in the world which has more black people, you know, outside Africa.
Oh yeah, that's right. So that's right.
Have you been there?
No, I've only been to Brasilia.
Brasilia, that's right.
Yeah, so that means that if you're talking about black people, you have to be talking about these two countries.
Yeah.
But generally when we talk about black people, it's the United States, because of the power that America has. You know, when we're talking about black people, it's generally, you know, we're thinking of the US. So I think that there's a lot that these two countries can do, you know, to help the cause of black people across the world. I always say that Nigeria should be that country which has to stand. You know, like if you think about the fate of the Asian person, back in the 60s, 70s, even 80s, the Asian was seen as the sick man of the world. You know, it was like, you know, yeah, they were not enslaved and all that, but they were seen as inferior. But the rise of Japan and China and South Korea has put a lot of, you know, you see what I'm saying? So it has put a lot of prestige, in fact, to them. But, you know, we have most African countries, most black countries are not doing well economically and developmentally, and some of these things we can fix. You know, like in Nigeria, for instance, we have wealth there, you know, but we just, sadly, because of the foundation of the system, it allows for bad players to take over. So there's an entrenched minority who take all the wealth and then leave very little for others. So if not, Nigeria will be, you know, will be given, it will be the place where if I feel, if I'm a black American and I don't like how I'm being treated here because I'm a minority, there's a great African country where they are all black people, you know, where people will treat me, even they will say, oh, okay, this is our brother from another place. They will give you everything you want. I would move there. You see what I'm saying? Like, in fact, in the 60s, you know, Du Bois and some of the, you know, African-American intellectuals were moving to Africa. Some people are still moving. They're going to Ghana, for instance. But that could, you know, this is why Nigeria, for me, is a missed opportunity. Because it should be the voice, as well as Brazil, that would start. But Brazil is a little different because the blacks in Brazil has been marginalized because they don't own the entire country. You know, they just own a region and then they are scattered amongst the people. So, but Nigeria is 97% black. Yeah. So we should, you know, naturally. Have the beacon. Yeah.
Yeah, naturally. Would you attribute the situation in Brazil to a lack of union, a lack of black union, for example?
In some ways, yes. Like, you know, one thing that has happened in Brazil is there's been a lot of intermarriage over a long time. And really, there are some Brazilian black people that, you know, from my knowledge and my little experience, that, you know, if you even tell them that they are black, they might not even understand what you're talking. I mean, they know that they have ancestry that is black, but they don't really see themselves that way necessarily. So I think that could be it. I mean, one thing, even though I have a lot of criticism about some of the ways in which this current generation of African Americans are going about their fight for equality, but I really think that one thing I give them serious credit for is how much they have band together. You know, they speak almost with one voice. And once you move away from, you know, once you have dissent, they treat you as a pariah. You know, they really, like, if you, in fact, have a different opinion than what the group of, you know, the general black society is here, you are ostracized, really. So, and, you know, you're treated in a very difficult way. So, in many ways, I think that enables them to speak with one voice, and that also helps them to, you know, make some kind of progress.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Now, talking about colonial times when Portuguese decided to change solely the trade of commodities into the trade of humans, bringing them to South America, for example. How do you feel about the legacy of Nigeria's involvement in the transatlantic slave trade in both sides of the Atlantic?
So there are a lot of things that happened at that time. I think it's a very complicated history, but it's a sad phenomenon indeed. It really is. I think it took some time for people to know where these folks were going to. Yes. I think, so the trade, at least in Nigeria, probably took place for about 150 years or even more than that. You know, I think it's, no, actually, it was more than that. Beginning of the 17th century to about 200 years, let's say, or thereabout. So for like half of that time, there were only rumors, you know, in the towns and villages where these people were going. In fact, there were some slaves who sometimes would fight their way back or would bribe. You know, there are stories, for instance, from my part of Nigeria, like one woman who, you know, was told that if she would allow, you know, the captors to sleep with her, you know, and all that, they would send her back, and she did, and they sent her back, and she was pregnant with twins. You know, so she came back to the village and gave birth to these children who, you know, were like, she and the children were, you know, like stories that were told about them. So there were some of them who came back, and people thought, well, maybe they were just going to somewhere outside of the, you know, the tribal nation or something like that. But once they began to discover that they were actually going on a very far journey to the white man's land, and some of them were dying, a lot of people tried to stop it, you know, but they were greedy people. You know, there's a tribe in the east of Nigeria who, a particular, you know, today they have a city, Arochukwu people, who were doing conquest. A lot of them became very rich from the trade. So I don't know what the psychology of the people, of those people were. You know, they just probably saw it as, okay, this is a way to develop our city, selling people and then getting all these exchanges from the Europeans. You know, they were getting guns, they were getting tobacco, you know, and all kinds of things. But it was devastating to the African communities. I think that they were more of a victim than perpetrators. And still, even today, like, signs of, you know, the slave trade in these communities. So their best people, you know, people's wives, people's husbands, people's brothers were taken away. Some, you know, in the case of some, you know, one of our, you know, relatives, you know, story was told of the only child of the family. You know, they spent about 20 years trying to have a child. And the only child of the family, he was about 11 years old, was taken, you know, and it was devastating. So it was there today because of, you know, all these things that people say. People only want to see the bad things, you know, about. Maybe judge people in a particular way. But I think African countries should be seen more as victims as well, because these are our people. Certain villages were emptied, you know, of their able-bodied people, you know. And also, you have to also think about the fact that Europeans were ruling. So sometimes the people who were asked to go and get the slaves were, you know, either people who would be punished by, you know, the authorities if they didn't, you know, or folks who just had some kind of allegiance, you know, to the Europeans. There were some people who would sell out their people, you know, their communities because of, you know, money and influences. So this was really the story. So when I think about it, even though I'm sad that some people from Nigeria participated in this, but we are more of a victim. Just imagine how big and how, so Nigeria is like 180 million people now, who probably will be like, you know, 400 million. You see what I'm saying? Like, that didn't happen. You know, so it's a big loss, really. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. I got this feeling too. One last question. Have you ever had an idea of writing a sort of tragic novel, for example, which would explore the transatlantic slave trade? For example, a man who's coming from the countryside of Nigeria, crossing the ocean on a slave ship, sold in the port of Rio and coming to a unknown destination here in Minas Gerais, for example.
I would love to write that, but you should write that.
Why not? Yeah.
Yeah, that should be your novel.
Yeah. No, your novel, sir.
Mine. Yeah, I'm a of minorities, though. There is a section there in which the Chi tells about. So the Chi is a reincarnating spirit. It returns, as I said, every few years. So in the 18th century, it ensouled he then saw the an African who was taken on the, you know, ship to America, to Virginia, you know. So and so the Chi tells the story of this character in the novel.
Muitos séculos atrás, incorporei um grande homem que foi amarrado como um animal sacrificial e levado para a terra do homem branco. A jornada através desse oceano se estendeu por semanas, por tanto tempo que cansei de observar as águas.
So there's a history. So it tells like the 700 year history of the Igbo people.
Mm-hmm. Well, I let you with my suggestion, right? So just think about it.
Really? Thank you so much.
And Chigozie, thank you so much for enlightening us. You know, you're a super writer, I should say. I'm just a fan.
Thank you very much. So how do you say your name? You said
in Portuguese.
Thank you
very much. Yeah.
Say again.
Rogério.
Rogério, okay.
Yeah. Just like Roger.
Yeah.
Is, right? Roger. So, before we go, could you please send a message to all black women or black men I have in Brazil and abroad, please?
Hey, my people, I want you to understand that, you know, this is our time, really, to stand up and take back our lives and explore. I want us to have courage to understand that there, you know, we have limitless opportunities if we can stand and say, no, I refuse to be seen as someone who is inferior. I refuse to be seen as, you know, member of a country that cannot develop. We can do these things. So we have to, I think we need a kind of confidence in our capabilities. Somebody said to me recently, you can imagine a continent who was ruled by, you know, and conquered for a long time, for 200 years, whose people were taken away as slaves. You know, so think about all the things that we have endured, and yet we're standing. You know, which other race can endure all of those things? So we're very strong people. We have to understand that and work with that.
Okay. Chigozie Obioma, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you very much, my friend.
See ya.
Inscreva-se no canal, dê o seu like e compartilhe com seus amigos. Seus tambores nunca se calam.